This is Matt Conrad, aka Grindo, reporting from Hollywood, California, with Ruslan Provodnikov and his manager Vadim Kornilov as they prepare for Ruslan's November 28th fight against Jose Luis Castillo in Russia. This piece has been quite difficult to edit and it's taken much longer than I would normally have taken. Ruslan speaks at length in Russian and then Vadim translates at length in Russian. So I've tried to blend Vadim's voiceover over what Ruslan was saying. I thought this would be the easiest thing for viewers so they're not constantly reading subtitles and they can pay attention to Ruslan's facial expressions and how he's actually communicating. And hopefully the piece comes across and you get the gist of what I'm going for. So Vadim, what time did you say you've been up since?
Well, you came here at 6, woke up at 5.
What day is it today?
Saturday. It's training camp. So it's part of the training camp.
It was Igor, Oleg, and me. We're like, let's go at 7. It's light at least outside.
Tell him Miguel runs at 5, so...
He says if you make yourself do it here, then in the fight you'll be able to find the same, you know? And you'll do the same in the fight. How do I feel about it?
Yeah.
I feel great. That means he's motivated for the fight.
So the opponent for November 28th is definitely...
It kind of looks like it might be Castillo. Everybody else who was on board, who we wanted, didn't, you know, change their mind or just didn't want the fight for good money.
It seems like it was a very good money for this fight to come over to Russia to fight.
Most of them were offered, almost double to what they can get in the US.
Why didn't you throw me the names to people who you offered the fight to who did say no?
Well, you know, the promoters were doing that. It wasn't me personally, but I know that it was Herrera. You know, that was our first option for the fight.
As in rematch
with Herrera. And then Zab Judah was the second option, and then we thought of Shane Mosley. You know, and most of those guys didn't want the fight, and it was about $500,000 that was offered. We were actually okay with fighting anybody, because Herrera is not really a big name over there, but he's a fight that we need to, you know, close the page on. It's a rematch that we need to do in the near future anyway. But the Russian promoter was interested in a name that was a little bit known in Russia. And Zab Judah, Mosley, and Castillo kind of fit the bill because, they have a name that people know over there. But we're okay with fighting anybody, you know. We had to cooperate with the promoter to make sure that they got what they wanted also.
Sometimes it seems with Ruslan that for a fight like this, which is not necessarily a title fight, it's going to be hard to get people to step in the ring with Ruslan just because.
Yeah, that's why there's sufficient money offered, you know. Usually the money closes all the questions and makes the deal, but you know, a lot of these guys don't seem to want the money either, so.
That sucks for you guys.
Yeah, well, we'll be okay. You know, he'll be fighting on a big fight next year, and we just have to make a comeback fight right now over there. You know, for the fans in Russia, they've been waiting for Ruslan to come back and fight at home. You know, he hasn't fought at home in 3 years. So, as a team, we decided it's definitely time to do that.
I saw an interview with you guys, and I think it was Radio Rahim the other day, and saying that has it ever occurred to you guys it might just make sense to be the big dog in Russia and get people to come fight you and build a base there? It doesn't seem like something that you guys are interested in, period.
We could take that route easily, and I think that, you know, Ruslan's one of the top Russian fighters right now in Russia. But it's not what he wants, actually. I mean, he actually didn't want to fight in Russia that much. And he only decided to do this one time because he wanted to do it for the fans. You know, he knows all the fans that can't get visas, that don't have the financial ability to fly to America to watch this fight. So he wanted to do it for his people and give them the opportunity to come watch this fight. But in the future, all he's talking about is fighting back on HBO and in the United States in a big fight. I mean, that's what excites him. You know, his trainers are here, his camp is here. He has a lot of fans in America. You know, I think there's some fans from America that are planning to come to the fight in Russia. And most people realize this is a business now. You know, there's not one belt. You know, the rating system is the way it is, and a lot of fighters get into frustrating moments and getting opponents and getting the fights they want. But at the end, it will all come through. You know what I mean? A lot of these fighters who we want to fight, the fans want to see the fights. Like the rematch with Tim Bradley. You know. a rematch with Chris Algier, a rematch with Herrera, you know, the big fight that everybody is waiting for with Brandon Rios. These fights are going to happen, you know, just like the Alvarado fight. Alvarado never wanted to fight Ruslan, but it happened. So I know it just takes time and all these fights are going to come through. And a lot of these guys, even if they don't want the fight, they're not going to be able to run for a long time. You know, the network has been, you know, HBO has been very good at pushing some of these guys into the fights because, you know, they're kind of like a rating system now. You know, they get the fights that the fans want. And I believe that they'll keep on doing that.
What, on the day by day within the camp, what do you guys just do to deal with the frustration? Because it must be frustrating. You can't get the fights you want and it gets depressing. And Ruslan's an athlete, and he needs to be sort of sustained, like psychologically. Like, what do you guys say to him? What's the psychological process?
Listen, we try not to tell him anything, and just let him train. That's, you know, we worry about that. You know, we've got a team that's working on that. We've got a promoter, and you know, we're working on the opponents and the fights. The less we tell Ruslan, the better. I mean, that's the case right now. I mean, we don't have an opponent yet, but he's already training for the fight for November 28th. That's the way it should be. You know, we figure out the problems and just let the fighter do his job.
What's the main comfort that you sacrifice when you're in training?
The first comfort I have to get away from is my family. I have to say no to being around them, and I have to get away as far as I can so I can focus on my training camp. That's the first thing that comes to mind. And when I come to training camp, I mean, I don't need anything. All I need is to make sure I have a bed, you know, so I can sleep, so I can eat. I don't need any comforts. I'm not worried about that at all. I just want to have my trainers, my training, you know, everything that I need for the training camp. All the comforts, it don't matter. You know, it's not about that. You know, I need a bed and a gym and my team, and that's all it is.
Here, I don't need any comfort. I'm trying. Как бы мне все равно, в каких условиях я буду жить. Главное, чтобы у меня стояла кровать, чтобы у меня все хватало для тренировочного процесса.
I saw that. Ruslan, are you married?
Женат?
Да. Женат, у меня есть сын, Иван, 6 лет.
And I have a son, Ivan, 6 years old.
Do you feel like you've adjusted to American life?
I like to come here, you know, I'm kind of adjusted to be here, and I like, you know, my fans like me here, and you know, I enjoy being here. I like the people here. I like the place in the United States. I like to stay here. But, you know, I still feel like Berezovo and Russia is my hometown. You know, that's where I was born and that's where I need to be. And, you know, when I come back there after the fights, I really enjoy the time. And I just feel like the people need me over there. You know, boxing is my career, but my people are very important to me, and I want to make sure that I give back to them and I can bring to them. You know, a lot of people put boxing, you know, as a business. A lot of people say that boxing is all about making the money, and they put money first. For me, money is not the goal. It never was, and I don't think it will ever be, because, you know, I want to leave a history. I want to be, you know, I want to leave something more. What are you going to leave behind? You're not going to leave money. You want to leave something behind. I want to help my people. You know, I don't want to only do boxing. I want to be able to help my people in other ways as well, and I want to develop my community and help my country in other ways. You know, just like Muhammad Ali and a lot of these other great fighters, to them, I don't think it was all about money. They had other priorities, other goals, and, you know, they developed their people. You know, they had religious views and points, and I think that's very important, because I want to leave something behind for my people, and I want to be able to come to my hometown and, you know, let them enjoy my success as much as I do.
Story of my life.
Yeah, it's good to see you out here. Yeah. The park's full. Good luck, champ.
Okay. Thank you.
Is it frustrating for you that, no, you can't, you don't speak English? Is it a decision you've made, or you're putting your efforts into other things?
Sometimes it is frustrating that I can't talk to my fans and to my friends, you know, that speak English. But to be very honest, sometimes during training camp, when it's tough and when I'm training twice a day, you know, a lot of people want to talk to me, a lot of people come to the gym, and sometimes I have to admit that sometimes I feel like I'm a little lucky that I don't speak English, because I don't want to be distracted a lot, and, you know, I don't have to do a lot of the talking. I do most of the training and resting, and, you know, it doesn't distract me, so that helps in a way. You know, sometimes I like to just read some poetry or memorize a poem, and you know, sometimes that gives me a lot more enjoyment than learning a language.
How nice is it having someone like Vadim? He's your age, he understands what you're going through in life. Now we see you in the ring, we see Vadim, and I think people sort of see you guys as, like, you know, as a pair, like kind of like brothers. How would you describe your relationship? Got someone your age, speaks fluent English, and like understands where you're coming from and
sometimes I feel like I'm very lucky that we met each other, and I think that whatever happens doesn't happen, and it happens for a reason. And I, you know, I feel like the most important thing is the trust factor we have. I can trust him with anything. He can sometimes say things from my name, and you know, I completely trust him with everything that I have to do in my training camp and my fights. And you know, sometimes he signs for me, sometimes he talks for me. So for me, that helps me a lot in just focusing in my training, because he takes care of everything else. I'm able to restrict myself from the rest of the world and just focus on the training camp, and he can take care of all the rest. And you know, I think that obviously this relationship that we met each other, that happened for a reason. It wasn't just a coincidence, because we've achieved a lot together, and I think that you know, it will remain and we will achieve a lot more.
You've had trouble getting opponents to come fight you in Russia. Are you sort of surprised that people don't want to come to fight in Russia for $500,000?
Yeah, especially lately I've been aggravated with that. I mean, I don't understand why people go into boxing if, you know, they... you know, it's all about getting the opportunity and beating the other guy. I mean, yes, you have to go to another country, but that's all I've been doing is going to other countries, you know. So here they're being offered very good money. They have a chance to prove themselves against, you know, prove themselves against me, plus they get paid well. You know, maybe they won't have a similar opportunity again. And why are they in the sport if they don't want to do it? You know, that's what the sport is about. It's about fighting, taking chances, and beating the guys that are, you know, maybe better than you. But I just don't understand. You know, some of these guys, they want to, you know, they don't want to fight me here, or they'll think about fighting me here, but they don't even want to fight me at all over there. What is the reasoning in that? You know, like, I just don't understand. You know, like, and they're at their home, they're thinking about it. At my home, they don't even want to consider it.
Let's not forget that he sent the last three opponents he's had to the hospital. And that is a part of this. No matter how, whether they want to say it or they don't want to say it, whether it's Bradley, whether it's Alvarado or the Algeria, he destroyed all three of those people.
None of these guys want a rematch?
No.
But, you know, they talk, but they don't want a rematch. But if you tell him go to Russia, you tell Algeria go to Russia, I mean, he's going to say, I broke my ankle yesterday and I can't fight. I'm telling you. But if we go to Long Island, to his hometown, maybe he'll think about it for a couple of million for a rematch. You know what I mean? So in reality, they're all, you know, it is disgusting. And I think it's, you know, it shows what kind of men these guys are. And, you know, we'll see. I think we'll get what we want, you know.
Are you worried that it will do more damage than good to fight Castillo at this stage of his career after some of the losses that he's had?
As far as I know, Castillo won two of his last fights, actually. You know, and obviously, he's a very experienced fighter. You know, he has over 60 fights. He's been in some very, very big fights and with big opponents. You know, yes, he's like 39, 40 years old, but you never know what to expect from fighters like this. I mean, if he prepares well, it could be a very, very interesting fight. I mean, this guy can fight. He's a very experienced fighter. You know, who knows what to expect from Castillo? I wouldn't be surprised if he prepares well for this fight. It's going to be a very exciting fight. You know, my team and I have our own strategy. Yes, you know, this is a fight that's a comeback for me. You know, some people think I lost the Algeria fight, so this is a comeback fight. You know, we're looking at big fights. We have certain promises from HBO for next year. You know, I know I'll be in a big fight next year. So, you know, I don't have to worry about what people say. You know, this is a big fight. I take it seriously. I never know what to expect from a guy that has, you know, 60 wins, like 50 knockouts. And, you know, he's a great fighter. I mean, he's a little older, but he's not as old as Bernard Hopkins. You know, you have to ask some of these fighters why they don't want to fight and why I have to be put in this position. Because, you know, there's big fights out there for me, like Danny Garcia, Maidana, Tim Bradley, Brandon Rios, you know, Matisse, you know, that's the fight that we're looking for. And ask them why they're not taking fights. Believe me, all of them have been made offers to fight me. And, you know, now Bradley is fighting Chavez. You know, ask him why he's fighting Chavez.
I know you like to recite poetry after your fights. Is there anything that you think is particularly meaningful that you would like to send out as a message?
Мы живем как на вулкане и всю жизнь играем в тир. В этом тире каждый стал из нас мишенью. И так часто называем грешным этот мир, а своих не замечаем прегрешений. Этот мир несовершенный, состоит из всех из нас. Он прямое отражение наших чувств и наших глаз. Этот мир не станет лучше и не станет он добрее, если сами мы добрее не станем.
I can't translate that.
You have to.
First of all, I didn't memorize it. Second of all, some of the words are difficult. It's really about a lot of people notice a lot of mistakes of others, you know, and a lot of bad things that other people do, but they don't notice a lot of the bad things they do themselves. So it's really about self-reflection that the poem is.